So, we are continuing our sermon series, Seize the Day. Last week we talked about the power of purpose and how we as Christians are a people of purpose and how important it is to be a people of purpose. Amen? What a blessing it is that we are a people of purpose, because for so long I lived my life without a purpose. And I was searching for what that purpose was. But now I know what my purpose is. And so with that purpose that you have comes a joy and a peace, right? Comes a strength, comes a confidence, because God has given us a purpose. We're not just floundering out there in our lives, not sure what the next day is going to bring, not sure what we're supposed to do while we're here. But as Christians, we should know that there's a calling upon each of our lives to fulfill. And we talked about that last week. We talked about Romans 8:29 and just how those who God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed into the likeness of Jesus Christ, that Jesus might be the firstborn of many brothers and sisters. Amen? And so that is the high calling of God upon every single Christian. Did you hear what I just said? I know I've said it before, but faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So I say it again. The high calling of God is that you be conformed into the likeness and image of Jesus Christ. That is your purpose in this life. Every single day, you should be focusing on that purpose in your life. Every single day, you should be running after that purpose in your life. Every single day, you should be asking God to help you fulfill that purpose in your life. You are a people of purpose. And I believe that as we run after God in that way, that as we're running after God and as that process of being conformed into his likeness and his image is taking place in our lives, that God will begin to highlight certain missions that he has for us to complete in our lives. These are things that we do. The first thing that I talked about in the high calling of God is who we are. The missions that God gives us along the way is what we do. And who we are is always more important than what we do. In the sense that we are children of God. We are to be conformed into the likeness of Jesus Christ. That is the high calling of God in our lives. And then he gives us little missions along the way that we're supposed to fulfill. Remember, we said that when you were born, God had already predestined you to carry out good works in this world. And so you have good works that you're supposed to carry out in this world. Those are the missions that we're talking about. And those missions are important, but they're never more important than the high calling of God in your life to be conformed into his image and his likeness. And there's a lot of people, especially those people who are workaholics, who can get real busy in the doing and forget about the being. Because you are a child of the living God. You are being conformed to the likeness of Jesus Christ. If you lose sight of that, then you can do all the doing you want. But when it comes the last day, he'll say, "Depart from me, I never knew you." Because you're all about the doing instead of the being. You are a child of God, and that takes first precedence over everything. You are to be conformed into his image and his likeness, and that's to take precedence over everything else. And then, you see, the disciples were with Jesus, and then he sent them out to do. You got to be with him and then get sent out to do the mission that God has called you to do. Amen? So we talked about purpose last week. And the number one thing we must do to seize the day is to know our purpose in this life. Now, the whole basis for this sermon series is Ephesians chapter 5. So go ahead and turn there. In Ephesians chapter 5, we're looking at verses 15 to 17. Ephesians 5, 15 to 17. And we need to really take note of what it's saying here. Be very careful, then, how you live. So we're looking at this in light of what we just talked about, that you are a people of purpose. And so now here it says, be very careful then how you live. Why? Because you're a people of purpose. Because there's a reason why you're here. You're not just running around here with no purpose and no reason. There's a purpose why you're here, and so be very careful then how you live. Not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity, because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the Lord's will is. In order for us to make the most of every moment, as it says for us to do, as it commands us to do in this passage of Scripture, in order for us to make the most of every moment, we must understand what God's will is. That's what it says. Understand what the Lord's will is. And there are many people caught in their religion that will tell you, and they use Scripture. And this Scripture is accurate. It is a Scripture that says His thoughts are above our thoughts, His ways are above our ways. I understand that. But right here it's telling us, know what God's will is. If you're going to make the most of every opportunity, you have to know what God's will is. And how do you know what God's will is? God's will is God's word, and God's word is God's will. So the more you know God's word, the more you know God's will. And so if you can't know God's word, you cannot know God's will. You need to get in God's word and find God's will and get God's will in you. And then when you have God's will in you and you know what God's will is, and there's varying degrees of us knowing what God's will is, it's a progressive thing that we begin to know God's will more and more and more the more we press in and seek Him out in His word. The more we seek Him out in His word, the more we know His will. And then we can learn more and more and more and more and more. And God, who God is, and God's wisdom and God's will is never ending. It's a beautiful thing. The more you press in, the more you find out there is. And you cannot exhaust who God is. You cannot exhaust the revelation of God in your lifetime. As much as you go after God, there will always be more of God to go after. Woo! That is exciting. It's an awesome and a wonderful thing. It's not hard. It's not difficult. It's not a heavy weight that we carry around. Oh, we got to seek God today. No, it's a joy. It's a privilege to be able to seek God. Why? Because every time you seek God, God pours out from heaven. God fills you up to overflowing. God shows you what His will is. God shows you what His purpose for your life is. And you get excited about these things. I'm not saying that you don't have to walk through some dry season sometimes, but that's maturity, when you can walk through the times where you don't feel nothing at all. We have to learn to be able to walk through those times, but God's revelation is unending. You cannot exhaust that revelation, and so God is new every morning. His mercies are new every morning, but the knowledge of God is new every morning as we press in and go after Him. So in order for us to make the most of every moment, we have to understand what God's will is. We need to also understand God's purpose for our lives. That's number one. And then second thing that we're talking about today is to seize the day. We cannot continue to look behind us. We cannot continue to spend our days looking back. The name of this message is Wrecking the Rear View. That means we got to get rid of that past stuff. We got to move beyond what happened in the past, and we need to take a hold of what God has called us to. Amen? So that's what we're talking about today. And in order for you to seize the day, you have to know your purpose, and you have to wreck the rear view. You have to forget about what lies behind you. And that's what we're talking about today. Who remembers the promise that God gave to Israel to give them their own land? Anybody remember that term, the promised land? So God promised His people this land. And then they went into slavery for hundreds of years. And decade after decade after decade, that promise of land began to fade in the hearts and the minds of God's people. and they begin to lose sight of God's promise. It's not a good place to be when you lose sight of God's promise. Come on now. You don't have to lose sight of God's promise, no matter how long. There was a guy named Joseph, right? He didn't lose sight of God's promise. In fact, as he got older and he knew that he was about to die, he made the people promise him that when he dies, they would carry his bones into the promised land. See, he was doing a couple things there. First of all, he was activating his faith. He was declaring his faith that we are still going into this promised land. And he was helping to encourage others in their faith to believe God to bring them into that promised land. Amen? There is a promise. There is a promise that God has given us. Every single promise. There's a whole book full of promises. Did you know that? God's word is full of promises that he's given to us. And the Bible tells us that in Christ Jesus, every promise finds its yes and amen in Christ Jesus. Every promise is yes and amen in him. And so there's a whole stack of promises that God has handed to us that's in that book. We need to dive in that book and find out what God's promises say. And then we need to trust him and believe him for those promises for our lives. Amen? And so we have this people that were given a promise of land. Who remembers that promise? And how many of you remember how God parted the Red Sea in order to bring the people out of bondage in Egypt and into freedom? You remember that story, right? How the sea was parted and they walked across on dry land. And the Bible tells us that the people of Israel journeyed towards that promised land. And as they journeyed towards that promised land, remember, they had spent hundreds of years in slavery, and then all of a sudden they're free, and they walked through the Red Sea, they came out on the other side, and now they're going towards the promised land, but they were just in slavery for a whole long time. And in slavery, I don't know if you know this or not, but in slavery, they provide everything for you. You don't need to, I mean, you work hard, but they provide everything for you. And so they weren't used to that. And so they started to murmur and complain to God. We don't have this, we don't have that. And time after time after time, on the way from bondage to the way to the promised land, God provided supernaturally for the people. And I want you to know that God was providing for the people on the way to the promised land to build their faith so that they could trust him to enter in to that promised land. And so I want you to know right now that the little things that God does in your life, the ways that God shows himself faithful in your lives, don't minimize that, maximize them. Praise God for every single faithful act of God in your life. Write them down. Put a date on them. Maximize them. And then when you're in a place of struggle, go back to those and read those and see how God has been faithful. Because wherever you're at right now, whatever the dilemma, whatever the problem, whatever the obstacle that stands in your path, God was faithful then, and God will be faithful now. Amen? And so the things of the past that we've experienced, we need to magnify and maximize those in our lives so that when the time of trouble comes, we'll think back on those things and say, hey, God was faithful to me then. He's going to be faithful to me now. We're not going to grumble and complain. So he promised them some land. He provided for them supernaturally the entire way to the very edge of that land that he had promised them. And then he instructed them to send 12 spies into the land. And even though God promised them this land, okay, God promised them this land ahead of time, and they had been told about the promise that God gave them this land. God promises them this land. And then they sent the 12 spies in to spy out that land. Even though God had already promised them that land, 10 out of the 12 spies that went in to spy out that land brought back an evil report. And what an evil report is, it's a report that's contrary to God's promise. God's got very many promises in his book. We don't want to speak contrary to what God has already promised us. Because God calls that an evil report. They said the people there are too strong. They have fortified cities. There's no way we can take this land. Let me let you in on a little secret. One of the reasons, and I'm going to talk about the other reason in a minute, one of the reasons why this people did not go in and possess the land that God had promised them. Wait a minute, God promised it to them and they didn't get it? There are lots of promises in the Bible that people don't get. God promised them this land, but they didn't go in and enjoy the promise. And one of the reasons why they didn't go in and enjoy the promise that God had promised is because, did you hear what they said? They said, these people are too strong. They have fortified cities. And then it goes on to say in Numbers 13, it goes on to say, we felt like grasshoppers in their presence and we looked the same to them. Do you see that? Where was their focus? Their focus was on themselves. Their focus was on themselves, their own strength, their own ability, their own skills. Their strength was on themselves to bring them into the promise of God, rather than their focus was on themselves to bring them into the promise of God, rather than focusing on God to bring them in. Amen? There's a big difference in that. When God calls you to do something, He's not calling you to do it by yourself. In fact, if God calls you to do it, God will go with you as you do it. You see, God will always call you to do something that's greater than you. And so there's no possible way that you can enter into the thing that God has called you to without Him. And He doesn't expect you to. But these people were looking at the promise that God had given to them, and they were saying that we can't do it because these other people are bigger, stronger, and better than we are. That had nothing to do with it. Absolutely nothing to do with it. You see, we need to get our eyes off ourselves and get our eyes on God. We need to stop trusting in ourselves and in our own abilities, and our own skills, our own strength, our own wisdom. We need to stop that, and we need to put our hope in God. We need to put our faith in God, because God is the God who brings us into the promise. Because I don't care how smart you are, I don't care how wealthy you are, I don't care how strong you are, you don't have what it takes to enter in to what God has called you to. And so we need to learn to trust Him fully. Numbers 14, 1 through 4 tells us a little bit about this. Numbers 14, 1 through 4. This is what it says, starting in verse 1. What happened here is that they're on the edge of the promise, right? They're on the very edge of their promise. The spies came back, they shared their story. And this is how the people responded. That night, all the members of the community raised their voices and wept out loud. All the Israelites grumbled against Moses and Aaron, and the whole assembly said to them, if only we had died in Egypt or in this wilderness. Why is the Lord bringing us to this land only to let us fall by the sword? Our wives and children will be taken as plunder. Wouldn't it be better for us to go back to Egypt? And they said to each other, we should choose a leader and go back to Egypt. You see, where there's not faith, there is fear. And fear will cause you to do irrational things. The most irrational thing that they could have done is turned around and went back to Egypt. Do you understand what happened in Egypt? Do you understand all of the plagues that came upon Egypt in order for the people of God to be released from Egypt? Do you understand what happened to them? Egypt just went through all kinds of craziness, all kinds of pain, all kinds of discomfort on behalf and because of the people of Israel. And then the people of Israel walked through that Red Sea, as we said, right? But I didn't tell you the other part, and you probably know it. That Red Sea dropped down on all of the soldiers of Egypt. And so most of the armies of Egypt died in that water. That was a watery grave for them. And so let me ask you a question. What do you think was left for them back in Egypt? What kind of a reception do you think that was waiting for them back in Egypt. Do you see what I mean? Do you understand what I mean when I say that fear causes you to do irrational things in your life? If they would have went back to Egypt, there was nothing but death and destruction there for them. But yet they still considered it and were even going to choose somebody to go back. Again, there was nothing left for them there but death and destruction. Their destiny was not behind them. It was in front of them. And I want you to know today that your destiny is not behind you. Your destiny is in front of you. What God is calling you to is in front of you. And so let me ask you a question. Are you taking a whole lot of time looking in the rearview mirror as to what happened to you in the past, or as to what your life was like in the past, or as to what you walked away from in the past? Or are you looking forward to the things that God has for you now? Are you looking unto your future? The Bible tells us that God has a future for you. He has plans to prosper you, not to harm you, to give you a hope and a future. And like I said, this future that He has for you is bigger than you. It's bigger than you. And so you have to trust Him to enter into it. Be careful then how you live. Not as unwise, but as wise. You see, this life that you've been created for, this life that you've been called to, is higher. Be careful then how you live. Why? Because it takes your focus on God. It takes your focus beating back the lies, beating back the deception, beating back the fear in order for you to walk free into the promise that God has for you and fulfill the purpose that He has for your life. Their destiny was not behind them, it was in front of them. Your destiny is not behind you, it's in front of you. Stop looking back. Stop romanticizing your past. There is nothing but death and destruction left for you in the things that God has brought you out of. Look at Genesis 19. We're going to look at verses 15 to 16. Genesis 19. Verses 15 and 16. It says this. With the coming of dawn, and let me just set this up for us a little bit. Some of us may know a little bit about this story, some of us may not, but we know Abraham is the father of our faith. We see him all through Genesis, and Abraham was a great man of God, and God called him to get up and to go. He didn't tell him where he was going, he just said go, and Abraham started walking, right? And there's a story about them coming to the land, and there was Abraham and his nephew Lot, and their families, and all of the things that they had were getting too large for them to stay together, and so they needed to split off. And so Abraham gave Lot the choice, and Lot picked the nicer place. But the problem with that nicer place is that the city of Sodom and Gomorrah were there. And I don't know if you've ever heard of Sodom and Gomorrah, but they were places of filth. They were places of darkness. They were places where things went on there that weren't nice. And so he took that place and ended up living in one of those cities. And Abraham took another place, and he didn't get involved in all of the things that were in those cities. And then it came to a time where those cities got so depraved that the judgment of God was about to come upon them. They had been given opportunity to turn, yet they hadn't. And they were horrible, horrible cities that lived in the filth of sin, and they refused to give up that sin. And this is what it says in Genesis 19, 15 and 16. With the coming of dawn, the angels urged Lot, saying, "Hurry, take your wife and your two daughters who are here, or you will be swept away when the city is punished." When he hesitated, the men grasped his hand and the hands of his wife and of his two daughters, and led them safely out of the city, for the Lord was merciful to them. Let me tell you why the Lord was merciful to them. One of the reasons why the Lord was so merciful to them is because of Abraham's prayers. Abraham prayed and prayed. He interceded for Lot and his family. He interceded for the people that were in those cities. He interceded to God and said, God, wouldn't you spare him? If there were this many people, wouldn't you spare him? If there were this many people, wouldn't you spare him? And it just kept going down and down and down until he got to like about 10. And God said, yes, if there were 10 righteous people, I would spare them. And so his prayers are what caused God to send the angels to bring Lot and his family out of the city. And so the angels are here, right? And it says here that they urged Lot, saying to hurry up and to get out of the city. Verse 16 says, when he hesitated, the men grasped his hand and the hands of his wife and of his two daughters and led them safely out of the city. For the Lord was merciful to them. As soon as they had brought them out, one of them said, flee for your lives. Don't look back and don't stop anywhere in the plain. Flee to the mountains or you will be swept away. And so there was a very clear and immediate warning that was given to them. It was urgent. And it says that Lot hesitated at one moment. When God speaks to you to do something, do not hesitate. When God speaks to you to do something, do it immediately. Why? Because God is calling you to do it. It might be for your safety. It might be for the safety of others. It might be for a blessing that God wants to put in your hand. It might be for whatever reason it is. Don't hesitate. God has plans to prosper you, not to harm you, to give you a hope and a future. Trust him in whatever he speaks to you and do whatever he says without hesitation. What did God say? God said, flee for your lives. Don't look back. Genesis 19, 24 and 26, going down a little bit. Then the Lord rained down burning sulfur on Sodom and Gomorrah from the Lord out of the heavens. Thus he overthrew those cities and the entire plain, destroying all those living in the cities and also the vegetation in the land. Verse 26, but Lot's wife looked back and she became a pillar of salt. She looked back. What is the very thing that they were urgently told not to do? Don't look back. You see, there are some people, even some people in the church, where God's word is a suggestion rather than an urgent command. And because God's word is a suggestion rather than an urgent command, that's why the destruction comes on people. That because God's telling them what to do, but if they don't do it, that's on them. God tells us what to do, but if we don't do it, that's on us. Now, God is merciful. But there comes a time where God is giving us an urgent command that we need to listen to God's word and understand that God's word is not a nice suggestion. It is an urgent command in our lives, and we need to listen and obey to what God says. God's word is not optional. That's why we need to seek after God in his word. We need to find out what God's will is, and we need to align our lives with God's will, because that's what a Christian does. That's what a Christian does. Again, the instructions were urgent and they were clear. Don't look back. She looked back and she was destroyed. Why did she look back? Oh, let's talk about why she looked back. You know why she looked back? Because there was something on the inside of her that connected with something inside of that city. She had an ungodly soul tie to the city. There was something in that city that she desired. And because there was something in that city that she desired, it caused her to be connected in an ungodly way to that city. And it caused her to look back when she was told not to look back. Lot's wife allowed her emotional attachments to the past. She allowed her emotional attachments to things in her past c- control her and cause her to look back, even though she'd been warned not to do it. You see, there's a certain point in your life where you don't have control over things. Actually, you don't have much control ever. You have some control over the decisions you make and the steps that you take. And then whatever those decisions you make and the steps that you take look like will determine your future. She had emotional baggage. She had emotional desires. She had emotional attachments to that city. And it's not something that you can undo in a second's time. That's why we are Transformation Church, right? Don't be conformed to this world system, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, right? And so whatever you give yourself to is what you will become. And so she opened doors to the lifestyles that were going on within that city. She opened doors to entertain that. I don't know how much she entertained that, but that was something that was in her forefront. That was something that was in her mind. That was something that was in her heart. That was something that connected her to that city. That was something that caused her not to be able to not look back. She had to look back because of her lifestyle and because of what she had allowed into her life. Do you understand what I'm saying? It's really hard to fulfill the promises of God and the plans and purposes of God in your life when you've opened the door to Hollywood. If you have more of Hollywood in your life than you do the promises of God, it's going to be real tough for you to enter into the fullness of God's purpose for your life. If you have more of social media on the inside of you and clicking on this and clicking on that, and you spend more time in that than you do in God's Word, it's going to be really tough for you to enter into the promised land that God has for you. Be careful then how you live. It's not about, you can't change things. Once the confrontation is in front of you, you can't change things. You can't get ready when it's standing in front of you. I know that that's when the urgency comes. I know that that's when we realize the need. I know that that's when we get serious, but it's too late if you wait until it's standing right in front of you. It's too late. You need to take time now. You need to take time in the times of peace. You need to take time when there isn't necessarily an urgency that's presenting itself. You need to take time now, because you won't have the opportunity when it's staring you in the face, when the confrontation, when the attack of evil, when the temptation is staring you in the face, you don't have time to run back and get ready. It's here now. And you're either going to face it or it's going to destroy you. And it'll depend on how you've prepared living up to that moment as to the results of what happens in that moment. Be careful then how you live. Not as unwise, but as wise, because the days are evil. Are you prepared for the attack of the enemy in your life? Are you prepared for the temptation of hell in your life? Are you prepared to take a stand for righteousness in your life? Or have you made emotional attachments to the things in this world more than you've developed the promise of God in your life? Because God's word and God's promise on the inside of us, God's presence with us, it's the only thing that separates us from the rest of this world. It's the only thing that makes us different. And unless we're dumping that in us on a daily basis and getting built up in our faith. You know what God does? You know what God was doing with those Israelites when he brought them out of bondage in Egypt, and they were grumbling and complaining? Every time they grumbled and complained, he met their needs. He met their needs. That's why I said magnify those times where he meets your needs. Because what God was doing was building their faith. He was trying to build their, he was giving them opportunities to exercise their faith in him, to trust him and believe him for the things that they needed. It's okay to believe God for the things you need. In fact, it's part of the plan. Because that builds your faith. And as you trust him for this thing, then God will bring you into something bigger that you have to trust him for. And it's step after step after step after step of exercising your faith in the things that you need that cause you to become stronger in your faith, to trust God to bring you into that promise, and to trust God for you when you have to stand in front of that temptation, in front of that thing that's coming against you. You'll be able to stand against it. And when you've done all you can to stand, you will stand firm. Because you're standing in faith in him. And he's built your faith over the years. And you've magnified those glimpses of his faithfulness in your life. And so whatever comes your way, God has prepared you for it. And you have what you need. You are fully equipped. Greater is he that's in you than he that's in this world. You can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. But you have to position yourself to be strengthened. You can't be relying upon all of the things of the world to meet your needs. We need to rely on God to meet our needs, because it's when we rely on God to meet our needs that he builds our faith and causes us to be stronger in him for what's to come. And I want you to know today that there are some things that are coming. There are some things that are coming. Let him build your faith. Don't run around letting other things and other people meet your needs. Go to God and ask him, God, how would you have this need to be met in my life? And let him build your faith to trust him in those different areas of your life. Do you have any emotional attachments to the life that you've left behind? Do you have emotional attachments and dependencies upon the things of this world? We need to cry out to God and ask him to give us strength, not to look back. We need to ask him to purge us from all ungodly desires. We need to ask him to empower us to stay focused on Jesus and to run the race that he set before us with perseverance. Are you crying out to God for him to help you? In 1 Kings 19, verses 19 to 21, we see a couple prophets involved here. We see Elijah and we see Elisha. And what's going on here is that Elijah is calling Elisha into the ministry. He's calling Elisha to follow him. And this is what it says starting in verse 19. So Elijah went from there and found Elisha, son of Shaphat. He was plowing with 12 yoke of oxen, and he himself was driving with the 12th pair. Elijah went up to him and threw his coat around him. Now, I want you to know that when that happens, that means that this man of God throws his coat upon another. It means that that person is being called by God into the ministry. And that they're supposed to come and follow that man of God and learn from that man of God and be raised up into ministry through that man. This is how God worked. And so he threw his coat on Elisha. And here was the response. Elisha then left his oxen and ran after Elijah. "Let me kiss my father and mother goodbye," he said, "and then I will come with you." And I just picture Elijah just continuing to walk like this and not even making eye contact with him. And you can see what he said, right? He says this. "Go back. What have I done to you?" That's how Elijah replied. "Go back. What have I done to you?" And he just kept walking. And Elisha ran back, right? And this is what he did. This is important. So Elisha left him and went back. He took his yoke of oxen and slaughtered them. We're talking about 12 yoke of oxen. A yoke joins how many together? Two. So when you're talking about a yoke of 12 yokes of oxen, you're talking about 24 animals, right? Not cheap. And the equipment that was involved as well. So Elijah left him and went back. He took his yoke of oxen and slaughtered them. He burned the plowing equipment to cook the meat and gave it to the people, and they ate. Then he set out to follow Elijah and became his servant. This is such a blessing to me. And there are different stories and different reasons for why things happen the way they happen with different people. But this blesses me because what I see here in the life of Elisha. Again, Elijah calls Elisha while he's plowing the fields. Elisha slaughtered his oxen, burned the plowing equipment, cooked the meat, gave it to the people. You see, what he was doing here, this was an act of faith. This was his declaration. I am abandoning everything behind me and moving forward in the calling of God. I am abandoning everything behind me and I'm moving forward in the calling of God upon my life. And what I love about what he did here is that he wasn't making any preparations for if this didn't work out for him. He wasn't staying connected in some way. He wasn't keeping something in the reserves in case he needed to come back to it. He slaughtered the animals. He burned the equipment. And he gave it all away. And he went and he followed Elijah. He wasn't looking back in his rearview mirror. He was moving forward in the things of God. Amen? And there are all kinds of different stories. I know the Apostle Paul, he was a tent maker. And so he was still doing his thing and still doing ministry. And I understand that there are different calls on different people. But this man was called to go and to do what he did. And so he killed the oxen. He burned all of the equipment. He gave it all away. And he went and followed Elijah. He wasn't looking back. Amen? He wasn't looking back. He was moving forward in the things that God had called him to. He said, I'm not giving myself any opportunity to go back to my old life. I'm burning every bridge and moving forward in God. Think about that in your Christian walk. Think about that in your Christian life. Are you keeping connected to your past? I just want to ask you that question. Are you keeping connected with your past? Because the things in your past are too precious for you to give up. For God? Are there things that are lingering in your life that are remembrances of the life that He delivered you from? Is there anything that you're holding on to in case things don't work out for you in this Christian life? Elisha wrecked his rear view. And declared that he was all in for God's plan for his life. We need to ask ourselves, are we all in for God's plan for our lives? Are we all in? Or are there remnants of our past that still linger? Luke 9:62, Jesus says it this way. Jesus replied, no one who puts a hand to the plow and looks back is fit for service in the kingdom of God. Nobody who puts his hand to the plow and looks back is fit for service in the kingdom of God. And so when we put our hand to the plow, when we go after God, when we're going after what He has for us, we need to keep going and keep going and keep going and keep going. We need to have the purpose that God has called us into in front of us. And we need to be going after it with everything that we have and everything that we are. Are you going to make mistakes? Sure, you're going to make mistakes. That's not turning back. That's just screwing up. Before I started this church, right? Most of you know this story. Before I started this church, I was like, God, what if I screw it up? And God said, I care more about your success than you do. So much so that if you screw up, I'll take your mistakes and turn them into masterpieces. You know why God was telling me that? He was telling me that to free me up. He was telling me that because he knew that in order for me to run at him full speed with this thing, in order for me to run after him full speed, that I had to be free and I couldn't be worried about making mistakes. God already knows your mistakes ahead of time, and he's not surprised. And he's there ready to pick you up and to brush you off and to get you back in the game. You just repent and ask for forgiveness and ask God to help you, and God will help you and get you back in the race, just like he did with Peter. You're going to make mistakes. They're not going to surprise God. God knows everything before you even do it. Just take it to him. Don't run away from him. Nobody puts their hand to the plow and looks back as fit for service in the kingdom of God. Don't look back. Seize the day. Be careful then how you live. Not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every moment. We're ending with Philippians chapter 3, verses 12 to 14. This is the Apostle Paul. And there's a whole lot that comes before this that's really good. I'd go and read that whole Philippians chapter 3. That could be your homework for the week. Meditate on that. Get it on the inside of you. We're starting in verse 12. It says, not that I have already obtained all this. He was just talking about entering into the call that God has on his life and being perfected in it, right? He says, not that I have already obtained all of this or have already arrived at my goal. Anybody already arrived? You already there? Don't see any hands. So if you haven't arrived and you're not already there, then you should still be running your race, right? Okay, just checking. I have not arrived at my goal, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Because I haven't finished my race, I press on. I'm pressing on. I'm pressing on. I'm pressing on. What am I pressing on to do? To take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. You see, there's a plan. There's a purpose. He took hold of you for a reason, for you to be conformed into his likeness and to live your life out, right? As part of the body of Christ, right? Doing the very works that God did. That's what you're called to be conformed into his likeness and his image, right? And here it says, right, not that I've already obtained all this or have already arrived at my goal, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Come on, man. You got to get this in you. This has to be a passion of your life. This has to burn on the inside of you to be more like him. It has to burn on the inside of you. It just doesn't burn. How do I get it to burn? You meditate on it, meditate on it, meditate on it over and over and over and over again until it becomes like a fire shut up in your bones. You can't hold it in. You have to speak it out. This is what God has called us to as his people. Not to be an irreverent people with a lack of passion for the very things of God, but to be on fire for what God has planned for our lives, to be excited about the purpose that he has for us, and to be running after it with diligence. Philippians 3, 12 to 14 shows us exactly how Paul did this. He says in 13, brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it. He says it again. And because he hasn't yet taken hold of it, one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. Yes! 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 This is the call of God on your life. This is the purpose he has for you. Are you burning? Are you burning? Are you burning to see this fulfilled in your life? This is what he's saying that he's doing. He's burning to see this fulfilled in his life. He's on fire for God. This is his one desire. This is his one focus. Even though he has another job. Don't get me wrong, he's got another job, just like you got another job. But he's still burning with the fire of God to see this come to pass in his life. I press on. I press on. I press on toward the goal to win the prize. Oh, are you running your race to win the prize? Are you running your race to win the prize? Not that I have already obtained this or already been made perfect, but I press on. I strain forward. Has anyone arrived? Has anyone attained it all? None of us. And because of that, we should still be pressing on. Pressing on. Pressing on. Paul gives us advice on what to do if we haven't arrived, forgetting what is behind. We need to wreck the rear view. Amen? We need to wreck the rear view, forgetting what lies behind and pressing on to what is in front of us. Yes, he has a call and a purpose for your life, a plan for you to prosper you and not to harm you, to give you a hope and a future, to bring you into something that's bigger than you could ever accomplish in your own strength. God wants to bring you into it. Press on, press on, press on. Focus. Forgetting what is behind me. You see, what was behind Paul, real quick here, what was behind Paul was position, power, wealth, comfort, and respect. He was a religious leader. He had all kinds of amazing benefits that he walked in. He had such respect from the people that he served and that were around him. He was a leader in the religious realm. Again, power and position and wealth. But he walked away from it all. And guess what he said about everything that he walked away from? He said, I consider it dung. Feces, if you will. Garbage. I consider it as nothing. All of the things that I had to give up, I consider as garbage compared to knowing Jesus Christ. He wrecked his rear view concerning good things that were in his life, positive things, benefits in his life. He wrecked his rear view and he forgot about those things. He walked away from those things and he considered them as garbage that he might know Christ. There's nothing in your life that has greater value than knowing Jesus Christ. If you give up everything that you have right now to know him, you're on top. You're ahead of the game. Because there's nothing that you have that's more important than knowing him. Though it costs you all you have, get understanding. Get that wisdom. Grab a hold of it. This is what we're called to as Christians. It wasn't only necessary for him to forget about the good things. It was necessary for him to forget about the bad things as well. Here are some bad things that he had to get past in his past. He needed to forget how he had persecuted, jailed, and executed Christians for their faith. Now he discovered that this is all true. And now all of those faces of all of those people that he had persecuted, that he had jailed, that he had executed, all of the faces of all of those people came up in his memory. I'm sure that the enemy used that every step of the way to try to discourage him and to try to drag him down and to try to get him into a place of darkness because of the things that he had done. There might be some things that were awesome, that were wonderful, that you walked away from in order to serve Jesus Christ and to become a Christian. You need to consider them as garbage in light of knowing him. There are some things that you've gone through. All of us have gone through some stuff. There are some things that you've gone through in your past. There are some things that God has brought you out of. Dysfunction. Abuse. Violence. Desires for other things. filthy sin that you wallowed in the old life, that God has delivered you from now. There are all kinds of things in your past that you have to overcome in order to get into the thing that God is calling you to. And every single person in here has things in their past that were unpleasant. But we need to get past those things that were unpleasant. We need to leave them behind, because if we're constantly focusing on those things, we will never get out of our past. We'll be stuck in our past. Whatever those things are in your life that you've experienced in your past, you need to die to those things in your past so that you can live fully for Him. Forgetting what lies behind and pressing forward to what lies ahead. Straining toward what is ahead, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward. You have a purpose in life. God is calling you to forget what is behind you. God is calling you to step into that purpose. God is calling you to run your race to win. Maybe you're listening to my voice today and you've never invited Jesus Christ to come into your life and be your Lord and Savior. This is the very beginning of that race. This is you putting your feet in the starting blocks of this race when you surrender your life to Him and ask Him to come into your life and be your Lord and Savior. That's when you step on the path of the plan that God has for your life. If you've never done that, whether you're in this room or you're listening online, if you've never done this, you need to take this step. You need to surrender your life fully to Him. And you need to run this race with perseverance that God has marked out for you. You need to be conformed in the likeness of Jesus Christ. You need to give your life for this thing. You need to surrender your old life. And you need to invite Jesus Christ to come in and to take over. This life begins with surrender. If you've never taken this step, God is calling you to take this step today. So wherever you're at, whether you're in this room or whether you're listening online, I want you to pray this prayer with me and mean it with all your heart. Say, Lord Jesus, thank You for dying for me. Thank You for giving me purpose in this life. Right now, I surrender to You, and I ask You to forgive me of all of my sins and to come into my life and be my Lord and Savior. In Jesus' name, amen. If you prayed that prayer, God did exactly what you just asked Him to do. This is the beginning of your new life with Jesus Christ. All of your sins have been forgiven, and you are now a new creature in Christ Jesus. He has a plan for your life, and we have a book for you. If you're in this room, they're right through this door on that countertop all the way to the right. They're free of charge. You can just grab one on your way out. You can read it, you can study it, and this is going to plot the course for you. This is going to show you a little bit about the race that you've been called to run as you've taken this step to surrender your life to Jesus Christ. It's called Now What? And it answers that question. What do I do now that I've surrendered my life to Jesus? And God will speak to you as you read through that, as you study that book. If you have any questions, I'd love to answer those for you. If you're listening online and you prayed that prayer, we want to get this in your hands as well. So all you have to do is just write free book in the comments section below, and we will get in touch with you and send that out to you. Believe it'll be a blessing in your life. I'd like to call the ministry team forward now. And as they're coming up, I want to ask everybody a question this morning. What's hindering you from straining forward today? What's stopping you from running your race to win? Is it condemnation from past events? Feelings of not being worthy? Is it struggles that you're having with familiar sins? Do you feel like you're stuck in your past? Are you having psychological struggles? Maybe you've experienced past abuse. Maybe you have memories of things that have happened to you in the past. Maybe you even experience nightmares. Maybe there's some kind of overwhelming fear that you deal with on a regular basis that's keeping you back from running your race to win. These are all things that the enemy is bringing into your life to try to stop you from fulfilling God's plan for your life. Could be the worries of this life. Could be stress or anxiety, oppression or depression, battles with physical ailments in your body, financial struggles that zap your time and energy. Whatever it is, you just fill in the blank. These things are trying to stop you from fulfilling the plans and purposes that God has in your life. And you can't let that happen. You can't let the enemy stop you from walking in everything that God died for you to walk in. So what you need to do right now, as we sing one last worship song, what you need to do right now is you need to bring that thing up to this altar right here. You need to come up front right now with whatever that is that's weighing heavy upon your heart and that's stopping you from walking in the fullness of what God has for your life. Bring it up and lay it down here today. Throw off everything that hinders and press on. Run that race with perseverance. Don't hesitate. Don't delay. If that describes you and if there's something that God has placed on your heart, I want you to come up here right now. We're going to start playing some music here and we're going to start praying for people as people come up. We can just stand right now and just pray to God. If you're not coming up, pray for somebody who does come up. And let's just worship the Lord with the worship music that's coming on right now.